Welcome back to Collective Violence in American History. In our last installment, we introduced some basic terms and concepts for describing and understanding collective violence. We started with the observation that most collective violence is rooted in human conflict, that it expresses a grievance of some sort, that it is a form of what sociologists call social control or conflict management, in which the perpetrators define their targets as in some way deviant, as wrongdoers, be it as rebels or oppressors or traitors or criminals or sinners or just a dangerous enemy that needs to be eliminated. And we discuss some basic theory for explaining why human conflicts are more or less likely to turn violent and why collective violence is more or less likely to be severe. We discussed work by sociologist Donald Black and by historian and sociologist Roberta Senechal de la Roche. And a basic idea is that the greater the degree of social distance and inequality between the parties in a conflict, the more likely that conflict is to involve violence, the more severe that violence is likely to be, and the more likely it is that that violence will be meted out in a framework of collective liability, in which all members of some social category, such as a race or religion, are held accountable for the alleged wrongdoings of a few. The plan for the remainder of this series is to focus on particular incidents or patterns of violence in American history, but given the importance of things like inequality or independence or intimacy or cultural distance in predicting and explaining violence, it would be a good idea to begin by setting the stage, by orienting ourselves to the patterns of social structure you find in past societies in general and in colonial America in particular. If we're speaking about the social structure of the past obviously includes a lot of ground, a lot of different time periods and cultures. But one can find some general trends. They're not smooth or linear trends necessarily, but general trends in social evolution. Many of these trends stem from the evolution of productive technology over the course of human history. Prior to about 10,000 years ago, the majority of human groups would have been based on some kind of hunting and gathering of wild food sources. And with the exception of a few unusually lush habitats, relying on wild foodstuff usually puts a low limit on population density. It takes a lot of land and territory to support a relatively small population of people. So these hunter-gatherers tend to live in small, semi-nomadic bands of 20 or 30 or 40 people. As time goes on and you get early productive techniques, things that we would call more gardening than farming, you start to get larger, denser populations, and an increase in social complexity that can come when you have larger, denser populations. You start getting more division of labor, more full-time specialists in various arts, crafts, or even things like politics. You start to see the growth of a higher level of organization. Most hunter-gatherer societies have no kind of formal leadership or governing structure. At most, you get someone who is influential by dint of their age or experience or force of personality. Little in the way of formal chiefs, let alone kings or hierarchies of administrators. In village societies, you might start getting chiefs, even hereditary rulers. And as populations get even larger and denser, with the development of things like plow-based agriculture, which is far more intensive and productive than gardening with a hoe or digging stick, that's when you start to get states, a much higher level of organization, and you start to get a much more extreme degree of social inequality between rulers and ruled, or between upper class and lower class. You start to see the growth of priesthoods and aristocracies vis-a-vis the growth of slaves and serfs. And perhaps a class of society that Gerhard Lenski, a sociologist, calls the expendables, people who are doomed in a world of primogeniture where only the eldest may inherit the land. What are those second and third sons going to do? Some go off to the cities and become laborers, probably to die young because cities are cesspits of disease in the pre-modern world. Others just go off into the wilderness to become bandits, also probably to die young, killed for their banditry. So the general trend here is that over time, the scale of human organization increases, the scale of political complexity increases, and at least to a point, inequality between people increases. Things like strict class and caste divisions, a gap between the nobles and the serfs or the slaves, these things reach their peak, depending on what part of the world we're talking about, in the ancient or medieval or even early modern period. And this is something that Donald Black talks about in his theory of moralism. If you really want to see the impact of social inequality, look to these ancient civilizations or to medieval Europe for an example of how law varies according to status, because the status differences are so stark that there is explicitly different law for the lower orders than there is for the higher ones. You can hear critics of the way law is enforced in modern society say that, well, on paper, everybody has the same rights, but this is just a ideal that's not often met in practice, or it's a pretty lie to obscure the fact that there's a different law for the people at the top than at the bottom. Well, in the ancient world, this would not even be considered an ideal or a pretty lie. Different rights and privileges for different social ranks were explicitly written into the law, and the idea that they should not be there would be seen as insane. The nobility of past societies often view their commoners as a distinct sort of person, almost a subspecies of the human race. And sometimes this is connected to real ethnic differences between them if the nobility arose through some sort of external conquest. But also, you have to think that the commoners and the nobles will look very different simply because of the conditions of their life being so different. As recently as the year 1800, if you look at the average height of recruits to the British Royal Navy, which recruited mostly from the lower class, would have been about 10 inches shorter than the average height of recruits to the British Royal Academy, which trained the officer class. This difference is due to differences in health and nutrition between the different social classes, and it's somewhat magnified by the fact that recruits in both cases are in their early teens, which is another difference between the modern world and the pre-modern world. It used to be that childhood ended much earlier, at an age when the typical American teenager is first getting their learner's permit for an automobile. A teenager in earlier periods might be going off to fight in a war. So some of that height difference might even out over time as the lower class recruits get their growth spurts slightly later than the upper class recruits, but it wouldn't go away entirely. So as recently as 1800, we have a world where the upper class can literally look down at the lower class as being a shorter people. Also worth pointing out that since most people in earlier historical periods would have had worse nutrition, these people would have been noticeably shorter than most of us today. Now, going into the time that the Americas are colonized, the old distinctions between nobles and commoners are just starting to wane. They're still strong at the beginning of this period, but technological change and the growth of markets is going to undercut the power of the old landed aristocracy. The time period we're considering will see the growth of democracy, the extension of the franchise, and eventually the abolition of slavery. But the general picture of English and European society as our story begins, is of a place where the degree of social inequality between the bottom and the top is much greater than what we would take for granted. Another way in which the past was more of a world of extremes has to do with patterns of social closeness and social distance. This too is something that Donald Black has talked about in his work. And it's something you can sum up in the idea that in the past, people were simultaneously closer and more distant, meaning that the close were closer and the distant were more distant. You had more intimacy and homogeneity and interdependence at the local level, and you had a lot more cultural and relational distance between different localities. And to get a sense of what I mean by the close being closer, consider how different patterns of intimacy and solidarity were, even in the relatively recent past. To someone like me, who's a member of the educated classes, moving around is a normal part of the life course. Even if, like me, you grew up your whole childhood in the same hometown, you probably left to a different town or city to go to college and settled in yet a different place after that for your first job. Now, not everybody, even in modern America, lives like this. I have neighbors who are native West Virginians. They have known each other. They're a married couple who have known each other since high school, and they still live within a short drive of both of their families. The difference is that two or three or four generations ago, their experience would have been far more common, and an experience like mine would have been far less common. And you push things back even further to tribal societies, to small villages, to hunter-gatherer bands, and you see levels of intimacy that it's difficult for the modern person to even wrap their mind around when you have a society where the sum total of the people you interact with day in, day out are the same 30 or 40 or 50 people your whole life, with a little bit of turnover for birth and death, and maybe occasionally some intermarriage with the group on the other side of the hill to prevent inbreeding. It's hard to fathom how close these people are when their entire social world consists of the same day-to-day round of face-to-face contacts. And in a setting where privacy is next to impossible, whether we're talking about the San hunter-gatherers of the Kalahari who will all be sleeping around the same one or two campfires at night, or societies where people live in tents or teepees, or a village of densely clustered small huts with thin walls. This is a society where it's hard to keep secrets, maybe impossible. In his book, Moral Time, Donald Black cites the example of the Mehenaku Indians of Brazil, who he says are well informed about everyone living in their multi-family dwelling, as well as about virtually everyone in their village, partly because they can recognize the footprints of literally every adult in their community. Imagine having that level of closeness to your community where you know all of their footprints, everyone's. This is a world where you hear your friends and family having sex and engaging in all of their bodily functions. And as a result, there's not going to be a whole lot of shyness about these things. Donald Black talks about this too in his book, Moral Time. From the point of view of European explorers, many tribal people will seem incredibly promiscuous and open about sex. In a world where everybody has that high baseline closeness, intimate acts are far less likely to be seen as deviant. And on the contrary, any attempt to distance yourself from the group, to seek privacy, or to even be too taciturn might be incredibly suspicious. It might get you branded as a witch. As you go up the scale of social complexity, to societies with larger and denser populations, that intensity of intimacy might decline a little bit, but still it's going to be very high for most towns and villages. The population of the town or village might be in the multiple hundreds, and not literally everybody knows everybody else, but it's taken for granted that everyone you see is knowable. If you don't recognize them as an individual, you can easily find out which family they are from. Growing up in a small town myself, I would encounter something like this. Getting in trouble as a teenager, the policeman right away wanted to know who my father was, because even if he didn't recognize me, odds that he knew one of my parents were fairly high. Well, picture the past being like that, but only more so. I sometimes try to drive this home to my students by pointing out the historical oddity of the situation they find themselves in when they leave my classroom and walk across West Virginia University campus and find themselves surrounded by a sea of people they don't know. They don't know them personally. They don't know what family they're from. They don't know what town they're from. They don't know anything about them or where they're going. And they proceed onward, strolling along, just completely taking it for granted that none of these people are going to try to kill them, which isn't an experience their ancestors could necessarily relate to. Because the flip side of the close being closer, of living in these lifelong communities with very intimate ties where almost everybody knows almost everybody else, or at least takes it for granted that they can be known quite easily, is that there's a distrust and hostility towards strangers that seems rather extreme from a modern perspective. Even getting into the colonial era where you have people moving about all over the surface of the globe, the communities that they found will be fairly intimate face-to-face communities that by necessity are quite small at first and in which strangers are not necessarily trusted. Some early American towns and cities will establish what are called stranger police, a branch of law enforcement specifically concerned with keeping tabs on outsiders and new arrivals. Another way of thinking about this greater distance and closeness in the past is thinking about it in terms of social fragmentation. In older times, the world was divided up into a greater number of smaller political, cultural, and relational units. God only knows how many independent tribes and bands and villages existed in prehistory. But the general trend over the course of history has been for the consolidation or amalgamation of people into larger and larger political groupings ruled by bigger and bigger organizations. Clearly, this is not a smooth and linear trend. You have empires that rise and incorporate many different subject peoples and then fall apart and fragment later. But the smallest of these independent political groupings are by and large gone now, absorbed into larger states. And if you look at any modern state, you will often find that the territory it occupies used to be divided up into a smaller number of polities that themselves were probably much more culturally distinct than the different regions of that modern state. Take a look at a map of Britain around the year 800 or 900. There is no England yet, let alone a united kingdom. There is Mercia, there is East Anglia, there is Wessex, there is Strathclyde, there is the Kingdom of the Scoti, there is the territories of the Welsh who are still speaking Welsh. The same could go for any other modern country. Italy is not Italy, it's the Kingdom of Sicily, the Kingdom of Naples, the Duchy of Milan, the Republic of Genoa, the Papal States, all making war on each other and engaging in various political intrigues. And you can see the same thing even at much smaller scales of a kind of amalgamation of different local identities being subsumed into larger units. My grandfather, who is 90 years old, speaks of what things used to be like in my hometown, which by most standards when I was growing up there is a small town. I believe the population when I was a teenager was 2,000 people or so on a barrier island that's 8 by 3 miles in size. But when he was a boy, he speaks of each neighborhood of the town having a much stronger identity. When he was a kid in the late 30s and early 40s, he never saw kids from other neighborhoods except during the school year. In the summertime, you only played with kids from your own neighborhood. One imagines that before schooling in state schools became common, this would have been even more so. Along with this greater political and relational fragmentation, you would see greater cultural fragmentation. The overall pattern in human history is that at the local level, societies used to be more homogeneous, while differences between societies used to be greater. A world where travel and communication are far slower and more difficult is a world where local cultural differences can accrue to a much greater extent than a world of mass media and easy travel and communication where cultures can mix and shift about and blend with each other to a much greater degree across long distances, and where even if you don't necessarily adopt elements of a foreign culture, you're at least somewhat familiar with them. Here again, I try to get my students to understand this by pointing out how odd their situation might look to an outsider from a past society. Imagine some European explorer from the 1600s shows up in Morgantown and walks through the downtown campus and has to go back and report on the culture of these strange people he's observed. And he gets asked questions like, how did the men dress? How did the women dress? What sort of things do the people here believe? Our explorer, who's presumably a male, is probably going to be hung up on the fact that a lot of the young women in our society would, from his point of view, appear practically naked. Once he gets over that shock, though, he has to acknowledge that others dress quite modestly, even by his standards. Some might even have garments that resemble the women of his time. Still others he will be perplexed to see dress in the fashion of men, wearing trousers and with their hair cropped close, as if they were trying to pass for males. Still others he might notice here have headscarves that cover their hair and necks completely. He might even see one or two wearing a full body covering, including a veil that covers the face. Asked to describe other things about them, he'll note that some wear their hair long, some short, some dye it unnatural colors of blue or purple or pink. Asked to describe the men, he will have a similar variety of styles to deal with. Some wear beards, some are clean shaven, some have their hair in mohawks, some have it shaved off, some have it spiked up, some have it cropped short, some wear it long. Asked to describe their beliefs, he would report a stunning variety of things. There's Protestants and there's Catholics, there are Jews, there are even a few Muslims and Hindus. There are people who openly call themselves atheists, which might be especially shocking to someone of that time period. And weirdest of all, they're not trying to kill each other over any of these differences of belief. Now, I don't want to exaggerate the point. Obviously, there have been cosmopolitan settings in earlier periods of history, especially the capitals of great empires like Rome at its height. You would have seen a mixing of languages and beliefs and people of different backgrounds and styles and fashions. But for your average human settlement throughout most of history, at the local level, there's much, much more homogeneity. People practice the same religion, they wear the same styles of clothing, they use the same technology, They speak with the same accent and dialect, and all this is even more extreme as you go back into smaller scale societies, small tribal societies. And the flip side of this greater homogeneity at the local level is that there's greater cultural differences across localities. You will find people in a tribal village speaking a dialect that sounds very different from the tribe just on the other side of the hill, and that might be a completely different language from the tribe in the next valley over. There used to be far more different languages spoken on Earth than there are nowadays. It's not hard to go find a linguist who is lamenting the extinction of languages spoken by smaller groups as they get absorbed into larger and larger cultural units. And even among speakers of the same language, you can see regional accents and dialects fading away over time. My own hometown, my uncle and my grandfather and people of those older generations have an accent so thick that when I brought friends home from college to meet my family, they could not understand what was being said. By the time you get to my generation, people's accents have faded out, merging with a broader regional accent or maybe even a broader American accent, because we're all learning to speak from the same mass media sources as well as from our experiences in the educational system. And mass education shows one way in which the growth of these larger political units, like the modern states, also can help erase the smaller cultural units within their borders. States often have a homogenizing impact on their subjects, partly just because they're bringing them all under the same set of laws, and because they allow things like safe travel and trade within their borders. But also sometimes they are actively constructing a national language or a national identity and trying to fuse separate peoples. I'm sure there are several lengthy books you can find on how the French state has worked to fuse together the French people out of the various languages and cultural groupings of pre-modern France. The fact that in the pre-modern world, local places tended to be more culturally homogenous also shapes how they reacted when they came into contact with these foreigners who were more culturally distant. Because as Donald Black talks about in his book Moral Time, one consequence of a society where cultural homogeneity is the norm is that cultural differences are relatively more deviant. A foreign culture is shocking precisely to the extent that such things are rare. And you're not going to see many cultural clashes in history bigger than the one that happens during the Great Age of Exploration, when Europeans fan out across the globe in their sailing ships and discover the New World for the first time. And this brings us in closer to the beginning of our story in America. The Age of Exploration is a fascinating period because it represents worlds colliding on a scale that humanity has not really experienced before. Of course, there are cases earlier in history where people from one society will come into contact with another society that they previously weren't aware of. One famous one is when the Germanic peoples first come over the Alps and make themselves known to the Romans and scare the hell out of the Romans for generations to come. Or we have the historical records of when people like the Arabs or the Russians first met the Mongols coming off of the steppes. But in both cases, the scale of the differences seems a bit smaller than what we see when Europeans show up in North and South America. Now, the Romans might have been terrified of those tall, pale, weird Germans coming over the mountain, but those tall, pale, weird Germans weren't wielding any sort of drastically different technology. They had swords just like the Romans did. And when the Mongols come off the steppes into Kiev and Rus, the people who live there might not have seen Mongols before, but they are familiar with the type of person that the Mongols are. They've met other steppe horsemen. The Native Americans have never seen a horse, or a steel sword, or steel armor, or a firearm. They're dealing with a very, very different people, with a very different level of social organization, a very different level of technology. I think the closest analogy in modern terms would be if literal space aliens landed on Earth right now. Although even that doesn't quite capture the shock of this, because we've had generations of science fiction speculating about the idea of there being alien civilizations that have greater levels of technology and power. We would not be caught quite as by surprise as the Native American societies were. And this period of first contact and exploration is also interesting to look at from the European or English point of view, just because they are stepping into a world that is so unknown to them, You can look at maps written in the late 1500s, and they know North and South America are there, but they don't quite have the outlines of the continents right. They think California is an island, for example. And even going into the 1620s or 30s, which is after the founding of Jamestown in Virginia, when you have had some successful mapping of the coasts of America and of some of its waterways, the Pacific Northwest of the country is still just a big blank spot. No one knows what's there. We've mentioned how differences in productive technology often lead to differences between societies. You do get some intensive cultivation and resultingly dense populations and divisions of labor and large political organizations in places like Mexico, where you have the Aztecs, or South America, where you have the Incas, fairly large-scale civilizations with professional soldiers and priests and whatnot. But a lot of the peoples of North America, including in the eastern woodlands where the English are going to land, do not have that large level of political organization. They do not have that intense level of agriculture. Their way of cultivating maize is better called gardening than farming. This form of cultivation is less productive. It supports a lower density of population. And so these societies tend to have smaller numbers of people dispersed over wider areas and are themselves divided up into smaller political and cultural units. You do have some confederations like the Iroquois Confederation or the Powhatan Confederacy. These are relatively powerful players in native politics and will become powerful players in colonial politics for a time, but they're not quite state levels of organization. So what we're looking at here in the colonial period is a North America divided up into numerous different tribes with different languages and different cultures. And it can be a fascinating thing if you're not someone very familiar with the history of these cultures to just look at a map that depicts the different peoples who used to live on any given patch of territory in the United States. For example, I have a map of Virginia in front of me right now that lists the different native groups that used to live around the Chesapeake Bay: the Okahanok, the Accomack, the Kekotan, the Wicomico, the Sekouan, the Rappahannock, the Chickahominy. People who, if any of us know their names at all, we just know them as place names, as the name of a county or a river somewhere. But at one point, these people were all independent societies, all players in the great Game of Thrones that's going to take place in colonial America. And I do want to emphasize that they are players in the game, even though we all know the long-term outcome of this story, that these people are on the losing side of a struggle. I don't want to overcorrect from the old view of the natives as terrible savages to the modern view of them as some sort of fairy elves living in the woodlands in perfect harmony until the evil Europeans show up. They are people, and people are people everywhere. They have their own politics, their own internal warfare, their own power struggles. You look at the Powhatan Confederacy just a decade before the Jamestown settlement is founded, and Chief Powhatan will successfully conquer the Kekotan people. And in a move straight out of the playbook of conquerors all throughout history, he will forcefully deport them from their village and resettle them in other parts of his territory, something that would have seemed familiar to the Inca or to the Babylonians or to the Assyrians, done on a much smaller scale, of course. And while we can identify many ways in which the Eastern Woodland Indians, regardless of their tribe or language, are broadly similar to one another in ways that make them very different from the English colonists, they are, of course, divided up into different languages and cultural groups. And for that matter, we should keep in mind that the settlers themselves are not one unified people, but several different peoples with their own cultures and their own politics. The most obvious divisions are between the different nation states. France is founding New France up in what's now Canada and parts of Maine. Spanish America includes Florida and the American Southwest. And even those English colonies on the eastern seaboard, while they are to some extent all answering to the government back in England, they are indeed separate colonies, each with their own culture and their own political structure. This is a point that historian David Hackett Fisher develops in his book Albion Seed, where he examines in great detail four different cultural groups that come from different parts of the British Isles and each create their own breed of colonial society. Writer Colin Woodard would later expand this argument and add some extra categories in his book American Nations. And here I'll focus on the four categories that these writers have in common, one of which is a group of people who come out of the East Anglia region of England and who settle in cold, rocky New England, founding colonies at Plymouth and in Massachusetts Bay.
And these people are the Puritans.
Woodard refers to the cultural territory they found as Yankeedom. The Puritans are Calvinists. They are a Protestant sect that is at that time clashing with the Church of England. They are a highly educated people. They have a literacy rate twice the average of England at that time. Their ranks are drawn disproportionately from scholars and educated professionals. And they are a very zealous and ideological people. They are coming to America to found an explicitly religious society. And the society that they will create in colonial New England is a
theocracy, a society ruled by religious officials.
Fisher recounts the story of somebody who encountered a pastor in New England and asked him, "Are you the parson who serves this community?" And the parson corrects him and says, "No, I am the parson who rules this community." Their society is almost totalitarian. There is no distinction between public and private vice, since the sins of any one person might endanger the entire community in the eyes of God. They are very much into one another's business, something that's a little easier for them to accomplish given that their settlements tend to be fairly tightly clustered and dense. They arrange their towns around a central location, including the church, with the farm fields radiating outwards in a circle from there. On Sundays, people go to church almost all day, and services will include members of the community confessing their sins and crawling around on all fours and begging forgiveness from their fellows. But it's worth pointing out, for as uptight as the Puritans are about vice and sin and crime, they're not necessarily a pleasure-rejecting people, and a lot of the stereotypes we have of Puritanism these days might not quite be accurate. For example, even though they strongly condemn fornication and adultery, they don't really have a problem with sex within the confines of marriage. They're not embarrassed by sex as such, and they view it as a healthy and natural thing. And you can actually find court cases from colonial New England of Puritan women taking their husbands to court and suing them for failing to perform their husbandly duties in the bedroom. But they certainly are a zealous and crusading sort of people, prone to force their own religious and moral ideas on others, which means they're colony will not be a colony with any kind of tolerance for the wrong beliefs and behaviors. They will persecute religious minorities, though it's worth saying that the Puritans are a fairly orderly and law-oriented people, so the persecution will usually be persecution via the courts rather than any sort of mob justice. One of these religious minorities that the Puritans will persecute in their colony is the Quakers, and the Quakers are another of the big cultural influences on early America. One of Fisher and Woodard's different American nations. The Quakers are a persecuted religious minority from the northern part of England, and if the Puritans tend to be drawn from the educated and professional sort of English, the Quakers tend to be drawn more from the ranks of the small shopkeepers and businessmen. And when they come to America, they will settle in a region south of Puritan New England, a region that Woodard calls the Midlands, where they will found the colony of Pennsylvania, including its capital city, Philadelphia. Now, the Quakers are themselves intensely religious to people at the time, and maybe even to observers today, they would seem something like a religious cult. But their religion is different than that of the Puritans, and in fact, one of their core beliefs is in freedom of conscience, freedom of religion for other people. So while the Pennsylvania colony is like the New England colonies founded by religious people, it is one that enshrines freedom of religion in its law and custom. The Quakers are an unusually tolerant people for this age, and furthermore, they're strict pacifists. They don't believe in violence and fighting. One result of these two traits is that relations between Pennsylvania colony and its Native American neighbors will be relatively peaceful for relatively longer than in the other colonies. The founder of Pennsylvania, William Penn, goes so far as to learn the language of the native Delaware Indians, or Lenape people, so as to better negotiate a treaty with them. And this treaty will be more or less honored by both sides for longer than a human lifetime, which is pretty good as far as these things go. Another consequence of the Quakers being an extremely tolerant people is they will let all kinds of non-Quakers immigrate to their colony. to the point where eventually they begin to lose cultural and political influence over their own colony. In 1750, the Quakers are the third largest religion in America. By 1820, they are down to being the ninth largest, and by that time, there's very few prominent Quaker politicians left. On the road to this decline in political influence, they will bump heads with other cultural groups in America, including groups that they quite tolerantly let into their own colony. And one of these groups is a group called the Scots-Irish, though they are neither Scottish nor Irish. Hackett prefers to call them the Borderers, because the place that they originate from is the borderlands between Scotland and England. Remember how I said that in the past, there was no United Kingdom. It took a lot of years of warfare and conflict to make Britain Britain. Well, a lot of that involved warfare between the English and the Scottish, which means that the region between the two countries is something of a lawless frontier, a no man's land that is periodically ruined by marching soldiers of one side or the other. And the people who live in this no man's land become a rough people, mostly farmers and herders, who themselves are fairly clannish. They have tight-knit family and local groups and are somewhat suspicious of outsiders. They live by the code of the feud. They are a hard-drinking, hard-fighting, martial sort of people. And when England and Scotland finally make peace, they find that they no longer want these rough people living in a land that is no longer supposed to be lawless. So if through various methods of persecution and taxation, these people are forced out of the English-Scottish borderlands. Many of them will sojourn for a time in Northern Ireland and Ulster, which is why they're sometimes called the Scots-Irish. But their ultimate destination is going to be America. Only which American colony would be tolerant enough to allow in thousands and thousands, actually something like 200,000, of these relatively poor and wild people? Well, our friends the Quakers in Pennsylvania will allow it. So you will see hundreds of thousands of Scots-Irish borderers traveling to Pennsylvania in a relatively short period of time. Only when they get to Pennsylvania, they're not able to settle in always sunny Philadelphia. All that land along the coast is already occupied and fairly expensive. So the place that they'll be going to is the frontier in the foothills of the Appalachian Mountains. And from there, they will spread up and down the spine of the Appalachians. This is the origin story, says Fisher, of modern hillbillies. And settling in the mountains along the frontier does nothing to make them any less rough or tough or clannish. One can only imagine how difficult it was to build and live and farm in Appalachia in the era before modern technology. And one can only imagine how frightening it was to be on the frontier at the very edge of English influence, days away from any colonial militia, in an era when you're going to have frequent conflicts with the natives, raids and attacks and warfare back and forth. These people remain a martial people who will fight at the drop of a hat. They have their own breed of honor culture with a strong emphasis on personal bravery and manly toughness. And they don't particularly get along very well with any of the neighboring cultures. Neither the Quakers nor the Puritans will like them very much, and the feeling is mutual. One Pennsylvania writer called them the scum of two nations, and Puritan missionaries who would try to do work in Appalachia would complain about what heathens the people there were, even though, of course, the people there were Christians themselves, just a different stripe than the kind you find in New England. In addition to not getting along with the Quakers or the Puritans, the borderers will have their differences with the fourth major cultural group to come out of England, and that is the Cavaliers. These are the people who settle the Tidewater region of Virginia and Maryland. The Cavaliers are English aristocrats, and they are coming to America to establish an aristocratic society. Their society will be based around plantation agriculture of cash crops like tobacco and cotton. There's going to be a very large gap in status between your smallholding farmers and the owners of these giant plantations, as well as a huge gap in status between the owners of those plantations and the servants or slaves who work on them. As aristocrats, the Cavaliers are far more comfortable with a big gap in status between the elite and the commoners. As is common among aristocrats in older times, they also have a strong culture of personal honor, where men continually compete to display their prowess and bravery. The Southern planter class from the early days has a reputation for drinking like fish, for gambling as an almost social obligation. They will bet on anything in which there's an element of chance, and for resorting to violence to settle conflicts among themselves. The South is the region of the country where dueling is most frequently practiced and will be practiced right up until the Civil War, meaning, of course, the American Civil War, I should specify, because shortly after Virginia Colony is founded, the English Civil War will take place. In the English Civil War, you will have the forces of Parliament squaring off against the forces of the King. The Puritans, the settlers of New England, tend to side with Parliament. In fact, many New England Puritans will go back to England to fight in the Civil War. Meanwhile, the English aristocracy tends to side with the king. And this is actually where we get the term Cavalier. It was a derogatory term used by the parliamentarian side to refer to the aristocratic royalist side. It was meant to convey the idea these were not a serious or humble people. They are a bunch of fashion-obsessed dandies, which is probably somewhat accurate given that honorable aristocrats tend to be very concerned with conspicuous consumption and with displaying the proper fashions. But the term sticks, and in fact, the royalists themselves will begin to adopt it and refer to themselves as Cavaliers. To this day, the University of Virginia football team is called the Cavaliers. Long story short, the English Civil War goes against the royalist side, and this produces a large influx of new Cavaliers arriving in the Tidewater region to settle amongst their fellows and to try to establish a kind of society along the lines of their aristocratic ideals. These ideals include each big landowner, each member of the planting class, having his own estate that he runs as a private kingdom. And of course, you can't have a kingdom without subjects. Who are the subjects of these planters? Well, with the introduction of tobacco pretty early on in colonial Virginia, you get a huge demand for labor. This in turn leads to the growth of a large class of indentured servants. People whose deal is that the planter will pay their passage from England to the New World, and in return, they have to labor for him for a term of 4 to 7 years is the norm, after which they're supposed to be given their freedom and something called their freedom dues, which is a payment, usually some quantity of corn and clothing, sometimes some tools as well, though sometimes there are disputes over these dues. For example, in Jamestown, there was a male indentured servant whose term of service was up, and he insisted on receiving his corn and clothes from his master, only for the master to fly into a rage and strike him in the head. Masters could, of course, be violent towards their servants. There are lots of cases of cruelty, overwork, and physical abuse towards indentured servants. For example, in 1624, a gentlewoman named Alice Proctor arranged to have her maid servant Elizabeth Abbott beaten, and the beating was so severe that it killed her. In another case, a mistress thrashed her maid servant so severely in 1649 that she left her head spongy and soft in spots and her back possibly broken. Colonial Governor George Sandys supposedly let his servants suffer from malnutrition and lack of medical care. Now, these servants aren't slaves, technically. They are free people who, in theory, have some legal rights. But, well, if they're not slaves, they are maybe just a rung or two above that. Because the way servitude develops in Virginia, it is a harsher form of servitude than what was the norm in England. And some people see it as, well, a step on the road to slavery becoming part of the culture of the plantation South. For as much as the Cavaliers are an aristocratic people, taking it for granted that servants should be loyal to their masters, England doesn't really have a tradition of owning human beings. There's not a big tradition of chattel slavery there. And while the tradition of having servants goes back to feudal times, by the time America is colonized, servants are very much not serfs. It's standard for servant contracts to have a period of 1 year, after which the servant is free to renegotiate the contract or seek a contract elsewhere, meaning that during that year they are obligated to continue working for that master. But if that master is unusually cruel or for some other reason the relationship is unsatisfactory, they do have the option of getting out in a relatively short time span. In Virginia Colony, on the other hand, the economics are going to push the planter class to extend the terms of service to try to recoup the large costs of shipping people over from England, and also to make up for the fact that for every 2 or 3 or 4 servants you ship over, you're going to lose a few. to death in that first season in the New World, people in Virginia Colony will speak of what they call summer seasoning, referring to the fact that there's a very high death rate amongst people from England in their first summer in the colonies. In the days without modern medicine, transplanting people from one climate zone to another often results in a lot of illness. And if you look at England on a map, it's about the same latitude as Nova Scotia. Yes, warmed a bit by the Atlantic currents, but going from cloudy northern Britain down to tidewater Virginia, which is not only further south, but much sunnier, and also in a lowland swampy area, festering with all kinds of diseases in the humid summer, yeah, you tend to lose a lot of people. So terms of service are extended from the customary 1 year to 4 years, or in some cases 7 years, or some cases even longer. If the servant is acquired young enough, they might be required to maintain their servant status until the age of 21, which could give you a little extra time if you get one young. There are also some other circumstances, some little catches that might wind up extending someone's term of servitude. One particularly shocking one was during the Second Anglo-Powhatan War, when a servant and her husband were captured by Indians. They killed the husband and they kidnapped her. She was eventually recaptured and freed by the English, at which point her master says that he's taking the time she was captive out of her contract, meaning she has to serve longer to make up for the fact that she was imprisoned and not working for him at the time. She also has to pay for the cost of recapturing her. And furthermore, she has to serve out the terms of her husband's service since he's dead and cannot serve it out himself. Speaking of female servants, if they become pregnant, even if the father is their master or one of his household, they can be docked the time it takes them to deliver a child and care for him afterwards. So that can be added on to the terms of their service. But generally, the goal is to prevent them from becoming pregnant. So it's actually illegal for indentured servants to marry, and it is also illegal for them to fornicate. They simply aren't supposed to have sexual or romantic relationships with one another because it can lead to that sort of thing and lower the value of a female laborer. If a servant woman does bear a child, the law says that the child must be taken from her and given to the church, and when that child is old enough, he or she will become an indentured servant as well, serving as one until age 21 or 24. And while they're not property to be bought and sold, much like a bank nowadays can buy and sell mortgages, you can buy and sell a servant's contract. So you will see masters, in effect, selling servants to one another. There'll be cases of servants who sign up to work for one person and might have a decent reputation. Then they get sold to someone else who's much crueler. You will even see reports of masters gambling servants' contracts over card games. So here again, a step down the road to being a bit more comfortable with humans as property. And of course, around this time, human property is beginning to enter the colonies. The first African slaves will show up in 1619, and they will be a relatively small part of the workforce at first, with the planters coming gradually to rely more and more on slave labor as the period develops. So we can see that even among the colonists, even just among the English colonists, there are going to be some major social divisions, some vertical cleavages, some cultural cleavages, and as you might expect, there's going to be conflict across these lines, and sometimes it's going to be violent conflict. For example, in Puritan New England, there will be violent persecution of the Quakers. Now, granted, this isn't the type of violence that's going to be the main focus of this series, because being an orderly and law-abiding people, the Puritans are not going to be rioting and lynching the Quakers. They will just use the courts to torture and punish them. Starting in the 1650s, you get a series of laws in Puritan New England making it illegal to be a Quaker. One statute says that any Quaker arriving in the colony should have one of his ears cut off. For a second offense, he will lose the other ear. Every Quaker woman should be severely whipped. And for a Quaker of either sex, for a third offense, their tongue is to be bored through with a hot iron. There's a 1661 law ordering that any wandering Quakers should be apprehended, stripped naked from the middle upward, tied to a cart, and whipped through the town. And in several cases in Boston, you will actually have courts pronounce a death sentence on Quakers. And these are not dead letter laws. These laws are enforced. There are several cases of Quakers being publicly whipped to the satisfaction of onlookers, just as there are several executions for the offense of being a Quaker. Way on down in Virginia, the elite are generally a little less zealous and concerned with religion. but they don't particularly get along with Puritans especially, and sometimes not with Quakers either. The governor of Virginia Colony, Governor Berkeley, will help enact a law to preserve the purity of the doctrines of the Church of England, a law that makes it effectively illegal to be a Quaker or a Puritan in Virginia Colony. The hostility between the Puritans and the Cavaliers is especially strong because these two groups come down on opposite sides of the English Civil War. This war lasts from 1642 to 1651, and the violence of this war even spills over into the colonies. A group of persecuted Virginia Puritans will travel to the site of what's now the city of Annapolis, Maryland, where they will set up a settlement they call Providence, a colony within a colony, you might say. Lord Baltimore, the royalist governor of the colony of Maryland, is not a fan of these Puritans. And in 1655, forces loyal to Lord Baltimore will fight a battle against these Puritan colonists. It's called the Battle of the Severn. It kills about 20 people, mostly on the Puritan side, and one historian has referred to it as the last battle of the English Civil War, though it happens, oddly enough, several years after the war actually ended in England. For that matter, I've heard people say that the American Civil War is actually English Civil War Round 2, since once again, the Puritan-descended Yankees and the Cavalier-descended Southerners will wind up on opposite sides, and the Puritans will win. So these fault lines between the English colonists can breed violence, but in the earliest days of the American colonies, each colony is going to have a fairly small population and be fairly internally homogenous, which limits the degree to which you get a lot of collective violence within each colony, and a lot of the violence that you do get will be more governmental violence than violence by spontaneous civilian groups. We should also keep in mind that these colonies are colonies, and while each has a high degree of autonomy, whether it's written into its colonial charter or just arising de facto from the great travel times between England and America, there is a government back in England, and the chaos of the Civil War notwithstanding, that government does exercise some authority and has an interest in not having its different colonies go to war with one another or slaughter large numbers of English subjects. There's also the fact that the differences between these colonists are relatively smaller than the differences between the colonists and the Native Americans. Probably comes as no surprise that in the early days of the colonies, the bloodiest fault line is going to be the one between the English and the Indians. This relationship will generate violence ranging in severity and scale from small back-and-forth raids and vendettas to open warfare to genocide, complete slaughter of entire settlements of men, women, and children. To the extent that these conflicts are actual wars fought by colonial militaries against a foreign adversary, they're not the main focus of the series. The series is not a series on military history per se, but we're going to see an interesting interaction between the social divisions within the colonies and these bloody frontiers. One of the first big spasms of violence you're going to find in Virginia Colony is going to be along that fault line between the lower class and the upper class. But that fault line is going to be exacerbated by the conflicts between the settlers and the Indians. Likewise, in Pennsylvania Colony, you have that division between the Quakers and the borderers on their frontier, and this too will be something that interacts with conflicts with the American Indians. In both cases, we will get an example of violent rebellion against the colony's leaders mixed with genocidal attacks against the natives. And we will talk about all that and more in the next installment of Collective Violence in American History.